नमस्कार डियर फ्रेंड्स, आई एम डॉक्टर शिशिर अग्रवाल फ्रॉम लखनऊ। दिस डेकॉन 2020 कॉन्फ्रेंस विच इज आवर ड्रीम कॉन्फ्रेंस। इट वॉज प्लान फॉर 30th October 2020, बट दिस इज़ वेरी अनफॉर्चुनेट टू से दैट आवर कॉन्फ्रेंस हैज बीन पोस्टपोन ड्यू टू दिस कोरोना पेंडेमिक। बट देयर इज ऑलवेज अ वे टू मीट आवर फ्रेंड्स। सो we have come up with the idea of this live facebook live challenge. Thank you Dr. Hetal for this facebook live challenge and testing. So pediatric anesthesia is always a challenging branch of the anesthesia. Most of the time it is limited to general anesthesia, but when we talk about regional anesthesia, it is usually caudal epidural. Spinal anesthesia is considered as a tricky and risky procedure. Basically, it is considered as it is a piece of cake for few experts and professional persons. But believe me, this technique is very safe, very effective. Let us see few cases. This is case one. This is 32-week-old cesarean delivery baby. Birth weight is around 1700 grams. He has history of surfactant therapy and there is frequent episodes of apnea. This case was diagnosed as a case of imperforate anus, which was planned for surgery. So what will be your plan of surgery? What will be your plan of anesthesia? Will you like to give general anesthesia in this patient? It may be risky. So I will plan here spinal anesthesia. Similarly, this is the second case, which is 6-month-old child. His weight is approximately 5 kg. He is planned for hypospadias repair surgery. He is totally ASF1 child. No congenital malformation, no comorbidness. What will be your anesthesia plan? Plan A will be general anesthesia with endotracheal tube and neuromuscular blocker as a standard technique. Plan B will be LMA insertion with spontaneous respiration and caudal epidural. But my choice will be spinal anesthesia with mild sedation. So in this case, this patient was induced with sevoflurane using this mask. Patient was positioned lateral over the pillow. This intercostal line was marked as well as midline was marked. Patient was placed over the pillow. For only demonstration purpose, I have chosen ultrasound probe, high frequency ultrasound probe, along with this long spinal needle and 1 ml syringe. So ultrasound probe was placed along the intercostal line in transverse plane. This spinous process was visualized and marked. After that, probe was moved downward and posterior dural complex, which is as a blue dotted line, it was visualized, and skin to posterior dural complex depth was calculated in the scale. Similarly, in paramedian sagittal oblique view, posterior dural complex was marked and this depth was calculated. After that, spinal injection was given and drug was delivered. So anesthesia was maintained here with the just 0.5% sevoflurane. Intertracheal tube was used here as a nasopharyngeal airway only. Surgery was completed uneventfully. Child was allowed only after 1 hour and he was pain free. This technique is not a new technique. This technique was first demonstrated in 1898 by August Bayer itself in an 11-year-old child who was planned to operate for sacrococcygeal teratoma. After that, several cases series were published by Brainbridge, Tigre, Berkowitz and Green in up to 1950. But after 1950, this technique was a forgotten technique. we lost our interest in subarachnoid block in pediatric age group because of the advancement in the general anesthesia. But this interest reappeared in 1984 after the paper published by the Chris Abhijan, where he showed advantage of spinal anesthesia in high-risk preterm baby. So as all we know that kids are not small adults. They have altogether different anatomy, physiology, and pharmacokinetics. These infants and neonates they have large volume of distribution, so they require higher drug volume, higher drug dosage to require same plasma concentration as to adult. They have less glycosylated protein and albumin, so more free drug will be available. Higher will be the chances of local anesthesia toxicity in the patients. They have immature liver. Their cytochrome 450 system is immature, so oxidation and conjugation will be slowed. So there will be risk of local anesthesia toxicity. These infants and kids have high cardiac output, so higher will be drug absorbed from any site, like be it be epidural, caudal epidural, or any other regional anesthesia block. So risk of local anesthesia toxicity is higher with all the regional anesthesia techniques. Up to first trimester, spinal cord and vertebral column both they grow together, but after first trimester, spinal cord lag behind. It usually ends at the level of L3 in newborns, but it reaches up to L1 in adult patients. While dural sac, it ends at the level of S4 in newborn. After 1 year of age, up to S2, and at the level of S1 in adults. We usually give injections close to the intercostal line or Taffias line, which crosses around L3-4. But in neonates, pelvis is small and shorter, so this line crosses at the L4-5 or L5-S1. This is the site, preferred site, where we give spinal injections. These neonates have higher CSF volume. The CSF volume in neonates is around 10 ml per kg, in toddlers 4 ml per kg, and in adults it is 2 ml per kg. So these kids, they require higher spinal drag to achieve same level of the block. Their duration of anesthesia is shorter because their CSF turnover is very high. Their pyometer is highly vascular and cardiac output is higher, so rapid will be the drug absorption. So duration is usually shorter than adults. They have incomplete myelination of the nerve. Their endoneurium is very loose, so drug usually penetrates very easily up to the nerve, so onset is very fast. Spine is usually ligamentous. Ligaments of the spine are very less dense, so filling of the spinal space is very less marked, so may be difficult to confirm the spinal space. We cannot give here paramedian injections because limina is cartilaginous, so we may end up into entering to the cartilaginous lamina, so usually paramedian injection should be avoided. So there is no lumbar lordosis or kyphosis of the spine in the pediatric age group population, so there is more cephalic drug spread in these kids. Usually they are immune to hemodynamic changes because their sympathetic system, their autonomic system is basically predominated by parasympathetic system. Their sympathetic system is usually immature, so heart rate and blood pressure is usually reserved. Their periphery are small compared to their body, so less peripheral blood pooling will be occur after the spinal injection, so lesser will be the chances of hypertension after giving spinal injections. But when we give very high level of drug, there may be risk of bradycardia. Respiratory system is usually not involved with the after this spinal injections, but after very high injections, there will be intercostal muscle spasticity, and it will be shown as paradoxical respiration. But it is very well compensated by the diaphragmatic movement. So overall respiration is not affected. If we compare spinal anesthesia with the general anesthesia, there is lesser risk of postoperative apnea with the spinal anesthesia. If we mention indications here, a special indication is premature child with frequent history of apnea. In those patients where there is risk of bronchopulmonary dysplasia, those patients who are asthmatic, spinal anesthesia may be a better choice. In those patients who have difficult airway or a complicated intubation may be complicated, like full stomach or UTI patients. In those patients who has history of congenital muscular dystrophy and having high risk of malignant hyperthermia after general anesthesia. In those patients who has congenital heart disease, spinal anesthesia may be safer than general anesthesia in these childs. A special contraindication to spinal anesthesia is a longer duration of surgery. We can give anesthesia only for 1 hour, not more than that, in those patients who have abnormal spine, because drug distribution will be erratic. So and multiple spinal attempts may be required in the child, may lead to nerve injury. In those patients who have degenerative neuromuscular disease, it may worsen this condition. And other contraindications are similar to adults, like increased ICP and coagulopathy. I especially want to emphasize role of spinal anesthesia in premature baby. It is a gold standard technique for lower abdominal surgery and lower limb surgery, because these premature baby have high risk of apnea. Post conceptual age less than 48 week, risk of apnea is around 5%, but it decreases to 1% up to 54 week of post conceptual age. They have high risk of bronchopulmonary dysplasia, so giving spinal anesthesia may be safer in the child. I must not say that general anesthesia is superior over spinal anesthesia, but it is a cheaper alternative. It may require only a spinal needle, a syringe, and local anesthetic agent only. It gives a good balanced anesthesia, good muscle relaxation along with good analgesia, and risk of postoperative nausea, vomiting may be lesser with the spinal anesthesia. Baby may be only allowed early and maybe discharge early with the spinal anesthesia. This spinal anesthesia may be an alternative technique over general anesthesia, where general anesthesia is not safe. It is not safe. It may be always a cause of concern that what will be the effect of general anesthesia on immature or premature baby. There may be some cognitive or behavioral changes after general anesthesia, but these effects are lesser with the spinal anesthesia. Environmentally, spinal anesthesia is always a safe option. One paper has published which showed it is a choice for cardiac catheterization with congenital heart disease in infants along with light GA, light general anesthesia, but it has some limitation. Longer duration surgery cannot be performed. Few kids, they require general anesthesia or sedation because they may not cooperate with you. It is a technically demanding procedure. First attempt is your last attempt. He will not allow you second time. So it is a technically demanding procedure. You should have an idea of depth of spinal space before giving injections. Pediatric spinal needles are not freely available everywhere. It is difficult to get. All the childs have fear of operation theater. They have fear of separation from their parents. They have some fear of injections. So every attempt should be done to alleviate their anxiety. Preparation is mandatory for giving spinal anesthesia. Distraction technique, it works very well for especially neonates and infants. Only a few balloons, these small toys, or running a short video in your mobile, it works most of the time. We can apply Emla cream in preoperative period, pre-op room on the spinal space, on the skin. Little older child may require IV or oral sedation in the form of pedicular syrup or midazolam syrup, but in toddlers, general anesthesia may be required along with spinal anesthesia. But we should be cautious while giving general anesthesia along with spinal anesthesia in premature child because they have high risk of bradycardia and apnea. OT should be clutter-free, it should be warm and calm. Instrument should be covered with the sheet. Most of the time in the toddlers, in these neonates and infants, preloading is not required. IV cannula can be placed after giving spinal anesthesia. But I will not recommend this technique and it is not part of my practice. This is always remain a topic of controversy whether we should give regional anesthesia in awake patients or in sedated patients. But there is lesser chance of nerve injury in a calm and sedated patients rather in uncooperative patients. So most of the time, sweetened flavored pacifier is sufficient for neonates and infants. Intraoperative sedation may not require in these patients because of the deafferation after the spinal injections. In one study, it was found that BIS score decreases to 66 30 minutes after spinal injections. Sleep is usually physiological after this spinal injection. When we plan for giving sedative, we should reduce our doses because of this deafferentation phenomena. Older children may require some light general anesthesia sedation or full general anesthesia. Most of the places we give ketamine in the preoperative room as a pre-medication, and after that we give spinal injections. But in a study, it was found when we combined ketamine along with the spinal anesthesia, risk of apnea is higher. So what is the technique for spinal anesthesia? It is a standard one, but either sitting position when patient is not sedated, sitting position is comfortable, or when patient is sedated or under the general anesthesia, lateral decubitus position is preferred. But we should have an idea. Excessive flexion of the neck should be avoided because it may lead to obstruction of airway. So neck and head should always be supported. We should have an idea of the depth of spinal anesthesia, depth of the spinal space from the skin. According to their age and weight, we should wait for CSF to flow because CSF might flow very slowly in the child. So it may confuse us. It may mislead us. Dead space of the needle and hub should always be calculated in the total doses. The dead space of the needle and hub is around 0.02 to 0.04 ml around. But if you are planning to give 0.1 ml or 0.2 ml of the drug, it makes a difference. Injection speed should always be very slow. Baby should be immediately positioned horizontal after giving injection spinal injections. Head up and head low position is not recommended. because lower limb will not be mobilized after the spinal anesthesia. So pulse oximeter, BP cuff and cannula should be positioned in the lower limb. So this is the position for the sitting position where head is supported. Baby should be positioned over the pillow or over the blanket when this lateral decubitus position is maintained for the spinal injection. It provides us extra space for needle manipulation. And baby should always be covered with the transparent drape to avoid hypothermia. Usually, hypodermic needles are available in our OT suits, and most of the time people give spinal injections using this hypodermic needles. But there is high risk of epidermoid cyst or growth formation after this hypodermic needle. Normal adult size spinal needle can be used, which is very easily available, but there are few problems. They are difficult to manipulate in a small baby. CSF will appear slowly in the hub, so it may confuse us, it may mislead us, and there is high probability this needle may break in small kids during when patients become uncomfortable or they move. Usually 2.5 to 5 cm spinal length is sufficient, it is required. There is one more advantage of shorter needle, because this shorter needle may bend rather break, so they are more convenient to use. Always better to use short bevel needle, because it will give you better feeling of the spinal space. According to a study of Koki, 25 gauge needle size is ideal, because with the thinner needle, risk of failure is higher, and with the thicker needle, risk of PDPS is high. So this is the pediatric size spinal needle, and this is syringe. Skin to subarachnoid space in newborn is around 10 to 15 mm, up to 5 years, 15 to 25 mm. In 5 to 8 years school going child, it is around 30 to 40 mm. According to their height, formula is 0.03 multiplied by height in centimeter equal to depth in millimeter, or 2 multiplied by weight in kg plus 7 equal to depth in millimeter. So how should drug dose calculation is little bit trickier in the small kids. For 1 month old child weighing around 3 kg, doses required of bupivacaine is 1 milligram per kg, which is around 0.2 ml per kg. For 2 month old child weighing around 4 kg, dosage required of bupivacaine is 0.8 mg per kg, volume is around 0.16 ml per kg. For 3 months, 5 kg weight, dosage are 0.6 mg per kg, volume is 0.12 ml per kg. And for more than 4 months of the child weighing more than 6 kg, dosage are 0.08 ml per kg. We can use any drug, bupivacaine 0.5%, bupivacaine 0.5%. Or levobupivacaine 0.5%. Whether we use isobaric or hyperbaric drug, effect will remain same. Though there is slight delay in onset of the effect after the isobaric or hyperbaric drug. If we simplify this formula, dosage is around 0.6 ml of bupivacaine for 3, 4, and 5 kg child. After that, 0.8 ml per kg. After that, most of the time 0.6 ml or 0.5 ml. Usually the effect is short lasting. So how can we prolong this effect? Either we can use a syringe wash with the epinephrine. Just take epinephrine and push it, flush it, flush your syringe with the epinephrine. But basically this is more recommended for tetracaine and xylocaine. This is not recommended for bupivacaine. We can add clonidine 1 microgram per kg, which may prolong duration of anesthesia around 30%. But with the high dose of clonidine, there is high risk of bradycardia, apnea, and hypotension. So these children may require caffeine after that. So in our routine practice, we add fentanyl 1 microgram per kg. Morphine is reserved for only post-op analgesia after cardiothoracic surgery. It is not routinely recommended. We can give caudal epidural or thoracic lumbar epidural immediate after spinal injection, or if it suits you, you can give after the completion of surgery. It is safer to give caudal injection immediate after spinal injection. Not many studies they are published. So how can we assess the block? In infants, pinprick or cold stimuli, it works. We can observe their extremities if they are moving or not moving. In children more than 2 years, Bowman scale is used. Ultrasound is basically, it is a new tool in our armamentarium. It may reduce attempt of spinal injections. We can calculate a proper spinal level from the sacrum upward. We can mark midline. We can have an idea of the depth of the spinal and spinal space from skin to subarachnoid space after calculating in the ultrasound machines. There is one important tip. When we planning to give spinal injections in lateral position, 45 degree head tilt, it will distend spinal space and spinal injection will be easier. Baby should be positioned over a pillow or on the top of the blanket. It will give you extra space for needle manipulation. Always calculate dead space of the needle while calculating your doses. Avoid barbiturate methods. In pediatric age population, incidence of postdural puncture headache is lower because they have larger CSF volume. Their CSF turnover is higher and their dura is basically more elastic. So risk of PDPS is usually lower and usually it is mild and it dissolves spontaneously. But in resistance or prolonged headache cases, blood patches are recommended in the doses of 0.3 ml per kg. And according to a study of Koki, there is no correlation between the age of the child and risk of PDPS. Whether you use a crinkly needle or pencil tipped needle, risk of PDPS is similar. Usually, hypotension and bradycardia, it does not occur after the spinal injections. If it occurs, most of the time it is usually due to sedation or very high level of clot. Risk of backache is around 5 to 10%, but there is no linear correlation with the spinal injections and the spinal injection general anesthesia with the backache. In 3 to 4% patients, there is risk of transient neurological symptom which presents with new onset pain, anesthesia in gluteal region, but risk of permanent neural injury is rare. Risk of block failure is less than 10%. Risk of high spinal is around 0.6%, where only supportive care is required. Total spinal is usually presents with the apnea, and there is usually no change in heart rate and blood pressure. In few cases, bradycardia and bronchospasm is reported. These cases should be managed with the control or assisted ventilation. To prevent risk of high or total spinal anesthesia, barbiturates and rapid injection should be avoided. There is one important tip. Avoid leg raising for application of tourniquet and application of quadriplate immediate after spinal injections, because there will this spinal drug will move more cephalic. So this application of quadriplate after immediate after the spinal injection, this is not recommended. So when you have to apply quadriplate, just lift whole of the baby. So don't be afraid to choose a different path than others. Always think different. So in a nutshell, spinal anesthesia is very safe and effective anesthesia technique in pediatric age population. It is gold standard in premature neonates. Duration of anesthesia is limited. So always adequate monitoring is important. Spinal anesthesia is safe, but adequate monitoring is very important. And always be prepared for general anesthesia because your surgery may prolong anytime. So always without preparation of general anesthesia, spinal injection should not be given. Thank you, dear friends, for being with me. Thank you, Facebook, for connecting my friends during this corona pandemic. Thank you.